Hello guys, welcome back to Dharma Geosphere. I'll be interacting with you on the last part of the paper 2 or geography optional, that is part C, and we will start now. The 6A question was, the digital divide in India needs a quick redressal to reduce regional disparity in development. Elaborate with suitable examples. Yes. The rural-urban disparity in computing device ownership is quite stark. That is very revealing. In rural areas, STs are at the bottom of the households who own any computing device, followed by SCs and then Muslims. Whereas in urban areas, Muslims and SCs are the worst of groups when it comes to computing device ownership. While STs and other backward are slightly better than this. In rural India, less than 15% of the households have internet facility. However, for ST households, the number is as low as 9%. Notwithstanding the disparity across social groups, the urban households are well placed and they are endowed. Nearly more than 40% have access to internet. Then if you see the other survey data indicates that 11% of rural and 40% of the urban population have above 14 years of age, can operate a computer, they are keyboard savvy as well as use the internet. It is difficult to imagine the use of digital platform but such poorly equipped communities to access public services. So the existing stock of digital capabilities remains limited even among upper socioeconomic strata. The social and economic hierarchies in digital abilities are a mirror image of the educational inequalities across different economic and social groups. Surprisingly, they are quite savvy when it comes to the keyboard operation. Due to the computing ability show, a disturbing regional disparity occurs among even educated individuals. If you see, educated individuals down south are more likely to be equipped with computing ability. Less than 36% of individuals who have completed higher secondary or above education, say in a place like Uttar Pradesh, were well equipped in computing ability. In comparison, in Kerala, close to 81% of individuals with the same level of education could use computing devices and the internet. So this regional disparity in computing facility once again hints towards concomitant regional disparity in the provision of quality education in India and the lack of adaptation to English in the Hindi heartland, that is the Indo-Gangetic belt and the central India. Since accessing a digital device such as computer requires a minimum level of English language skill, e-governance or ICT enabled platforms usually are available only in regional language and should be made use of in English language as well. So the goal of Digital India will remain elusive and far-fetched unless the constitutional commitments of ensuring equality education for all are fulfilled. So the government must shun the deeply flawed technological approach to eliminate human suffering and instead adopt a humanistic approach to tackle deprivation, including the provision of quality education through public deliberation, systematic investments and enhanced accountability. 6B is a very straightforward question. Avalanche is a major hazard in the Himalayas. What are the causes and mitigation measures? These are the National Disaster Management Guidelines. They have given what are the causes of avalanches. Causes of avalanches form as soon as the force of gravity on the snow cover exceeds its mechanical strength. They can occur also on slopes where enough snow is deposited in the right circumstances. So all the causes I'm sure you would have mentioned. And then the mitigation measures involves both structural and non-structural. Structural measures include diversion structures, dams, retarding structures and starting zone structures to design and prevent avalanche initiation. We also have avalanche sheds, and even forest management by doing a lot of afforestation can also be used to mitigate avalanche hazards. Coming to non-structural methods, it includes avoidance through land use restrictions or temporary evacuation and artificial triggering. And even you can have avalanche zoning like you do in an earthquake, kind of a preventive act. This is an interesting question. The process of demographic transition is not uniform in India. Examine its statement in the context of demographic transition theory. So here you'll have to write something, a little loophole in the demographic transition theory when it comes to applying in India, because India is a very varied country. The population also varies throughout the country. So demographic transition model is used to describe population growth over past, present and future. The model effectively describes and analyzes the transition from stable population characterized by high fertility, high mortality and high infant mortality and low life expectancy. So India is passing through, as you all know, the late expanding stage of demographic transition. It means that the total population of the country is increasing with declining growth rates. But the DTM is Eurocentric, so this is where you will have to highlight some of the weaknesses of this DTM in the application to in Indian context. So DTM is Eurocentric because as the model assumes that all countries pass through the same four stages. It is not necessary India, and you can't imagine the African countries to have that kind of infrastructure facilities and reach the fourth stage anytime in the near future. Similarly, in many countries the fall in the birth rate has been slower in stage 3 due to opposition by religious organizations. Not natively in China, the birth rate has fallen so sharply due to government intervention, zero birth rate and all that. So it can't be uniformly applied to all the countries. It has its drawback. And so also in India, we have our own wide variations in the populations. So the wide variations, you can write that over the period of time, India has moved from high stationary state to low expanding stage of demographic transition. On the one extremes, you have states like Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Goa who are on the verge of completing the transition. In addition, some of the smaller states like Manipur, Mizoram, Tripura are also found to be very close to the completion of the transition. Remarkably, these states are located in the northeastern state and a substantial proportion of Christian population, and probably the Christian missionaries probably could have helped them in having a control of the population growth. So a rapid transition in fertility and mortality rates in these states may be attributed to the birth of Christian missionaries. Because the other extreme, you have Bimaru states like Bihar, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, including Uttarakhand, that is the Hindi belt of the north, which are still in the early expanding stage of transition. So these are the wide variations. You can group the states and I'm sure you would have done it. The next question goes to demarcating seismic zones of India. So there are suitable interventions required in most sensitive seismic zones for sustainable human settlement. The Bureau of Indian Standards and the National Disaster Management Authority has classified regions into four zones. They are 2, 3, 4 and 5. Among this, 5 is the most seismically active region and zone 2 is the least active. So you can just draw the map and plot these four zones and then write about that the zone 3, the zone 5 cities, Guwahati and Srinagar are in zone 5, and zone 4 like Delhi, Patna, Dehradun, Jamnagar, Meerut, Jammu, Amritsar and Jalandhar. So these are quite sensitive seismic zones, and the suitable interventions for these zones are follow and comply with the different building code, the early warnings, coordination is very important, and detecting the rise of radon gas and analyzing the behavior of animals. This could be another way of detecting seismic activity, and it be monitored and used as an early warning system. Then capacity building of hospitals and other healthcare facilities, they all should be made ready, and proper coordination between civic and medical authorities, and drill exercise should be conducted for any emergency either in schools or colleges. Then what are the characteristics of blue flag certified beaches? Discuss their significance for beach tourism in India. It's a simple, straightforward question. Even during prelims, you have studied this. You know that government has embarked upon a program for blue flag certification for select beaches. This certification is accorded by an international agency, the Foundation for Environment Education in Denmark. It is based on 33 stringent criteria, and it's been divided into four heads. Based on this criteria and on these four heads, nearly 13 pilot beaches have been identified for the certification. And the characteristics of these beaches are: they have portable toilet blocks, change rooms and shower panels. They have grey water treatment plants, solid waste treatment management plants, solar water plants, purified drinking water facility, beach access pathways, landscaping lighting, seating benches and sit-out umbrellas, outdoor play fitness equipment, CCTV surveillance and control rooms, first aid stations, cloakroom facilities, safety watchtowers and beach safety equipment, etc. So by virtue of getting the certificate, these following facilities are being provided by these 13 beaches. And significance for tourism: how does this certification help? This certification, this kind, is considered important for both domestic and international tourism, as high quality services and safety procedures to attract international tourists. It also monitors high water quality, so it makes much more easier for them to travel. And the blue flag is also sought for beaches and marinas, and sustainable boating tourism can be encouraged as operators, as indication of their high environmental and quality standards being maintained in these blue certified beaches. So urban sprawl around planned cities evolve, leading to squatter settlements. Describe the advantages and disadvantages of such growth. This is another very interesting question. You all know that urban sprawl refers to expansion of poorly planned, low density, auto-dependent development, creating high segregation between residential and commercial bases. You have such urban sprawls in Noida and Gurgaon on the NCR, the Raigad near Mumbai, and also Sriperumbudur near Chennai. The advantage of such sprawls are it's less expensive, so anyone who wants to have a high kind of standard of living, they can go around and stay in these places, because large plots are available to afford larger houses. It can also create a kind of a local economic growth, as most urban areas are highly expensive, home further away from the suburbs. So simply put, it's easier to own your share of dream of a big house out in the sprawls. Of course, you have also very good schools because of the easy availability and cheaper availability of land and other educational institutions. Crime rate will be low because the density of the population is less, and it will take time for people who are trained in these kind of looting and crimes to all the way go there and do it. So that is one other advantage, but there are many disadvantages. So high water and air pollution, increased traffic facilities, and there could be jams because no proper roads or flyovers or overhead bridges have been constructed here. The agricultural capacity of these lands would drastically be reduced. There is a total dependency on car because the public transportation is not available. There could be higher taxes, increased runoff into rivers and lakes because it is uncontrolled growth, then it can have harmful effects on health. There could be increased flooding, etc. Thus, in its path, urban sprawl consumes immeasurable acres of forest, farmland, woodland, and even wetlands are all gone to waste. So these are all the disadvantages of urban sprawl. So analyze the changing nature of workforce composition vis-a-vis rural-urban divide in India. This is a very important question. You should divide this question into three parts. First, you say what is the characteristics of Indian workforce, that is young workforce. Nowhere in the world you have such young workforce. And then the skill base of this workforce, however, remains underdeveloped, and it's just developing. Most jobs are being created in the informal economy, which are not even registered. So you can say that in 2020, nearly 42% of the workforce in India were employed in agriculture, while the other half was almost evenly distributed among the two other sectors, industry and services. While the share of Indians working in agriculture is declining, that of the industry and services increasing. So you can just put this graph and show how the agriculture has been declining and how the industry and the services have been steadily increasing. So this is one changing nature. The other changing nature, you can quote from various studies and surveys done, that the rural divide has shown that there has been a significantly faster expansion of blue collar jobs, primary production and service workers in rural areas relative to the urban areas. So this is a very startling observation by the studies, and this is surprising given that usually blue and white collar occupations are mostly centered around urban locations. And then the studies also reveal signs of some interesting distributional aspects of the changes in wages and consumption, in that the rural poor appear to have gained relative to the urban poor during this period, whereas the rural rich fail to keep pace with the urban rich. So the rural rich is an issue and needs to be addressed. The other is the Indian economy itself is volatile and is dynamic and is changing. So the workforce also has managed to change corresponding to the changes happening in the economic sector and in the various organizations. So the organizations employing the workforce are greatly influenced by changes taking place in internal as well as external environment, and as a part, workforce are also changing. They want better salaries, better working conditions, defined career opportunities. In fact, it has transformed from collectivists to individualistic in nature. Earlier, all they used to be in groups to put in up their mind, but here nowadays, the composition has changed in such a way that even individualists are also having higher expectations, and accordingly they are putting up their demands. So there is also a change in the aspirations and expectations of the workers. The necessity of workers to have access to and the right of knowledge, culture and education is much more imperative now than ever before. Then another noticeable change is workforce on contract basis. This has been a huge issue for the last two decades, where the contract based workforce has been fighting with the management, and even so much so that you may remember that Maruti, the GM of HR, was killed, and also in there was a continued workforce unrest at Hyundai Chennai, and also violence at Honda Gurgaon, forcing the government to make them take up this and amend the contract labor laws. Similarly, there have been changes in industrial relations too, like workforce participation in industrial relations schemes has increased manifold, and now they are participating and deliberating on what should be best for the management as well as for the workforce. So, coming to the next question, this is again a simple general studies question. You all know about the India's interest in the South China Sea, the economic, maritime and strategic interest in South China Sea. So as far as economic concern, it is a rich fishing ground, and then 55% of India's trade with the rest of the world passes through the Strait of Malacca and the South China Sea. So our interest lies in India's economic reliance on trade to the SCS increases or decreases in the foreseeable future. Then the maritime interest, though we are not part of the dispute regarding the maritime territorial differences in the region, India sees both the general principle of the rules-based order and the specific issue of navigation between the Indian and the Pacific Ocean as core to its own national interest. So India must find ways to play its cards right so that it can leverage these disputed waters when the time comes to hold Beijing to account for the brazen border breaches and other transgressions, so that we can hold on to our stand and then bring them to the platform to discuss about these border breaches. And then the strategic interest, you have energy security, look east policy also you can try. Then you should give a naval dimension, where India's military diplomacy in the form of naval exercises, friendly port calls, etc. have increased in frequency since 2000. So the most vital of them all is that the country controlling this maritime route will have natural military advantages, making this region the geopolitical pivot to controlling the rest of the Asia. So India has to have its stake in both strategic, geopolitical and economic as well as maritime interests. Then what kind of skill promotion programs have been initiated for job deficient regions in India. Almost every region has its own job deficiency. So you write a general answer to this, that the government promotes all skill development efforts across the country, bridging the gap between demand and supply of skilled manpower, building vocational and technical training frameworks, upgrading skills not only for the existing jobs but also created in a way it's responsible for creating new skills and innovative thinking for the jobs to be done. And of course you all know about Vidya Kaushal. It's the first of its kind, developed to enable any Indian individual to apply for financial assistance or a loan to pursue skill development training courses. The other programs are listed here. You have from apprenticeships training programs to the craftsman training to green skill development to national qualification register. Then you have scheme for higher education youth, skill development for minority. So you can list some of these programs as skill promotion programs initiated by the government of India. So guys, that's all as far as the part C is concerned. I have analyzed 6, 7, and 8 questions in this part. I'm sure some of the questions were very interesting and very comprehensive, in-depth and insightful. This will, some of my interactions on these questions will help those who are appearing for 2021 and 2022. So please keep listening to these videos, because the questions may not repeat, but the topics and different dimensions of this topics will repeat and come for prelims, your GS mains, and also repeat in the geography options. So that's all guys. I really worked hard in bringing all the analysis of these questions, and of course I also enjoyed, and it was a learning exercise for me as well. It has broadened my horizons. Now I am also able to see the big ticket of how far the UPSC can actually go in picking up really insightful questions in the geography optional, particularly in paper 2. So please join me in preparing very well for the 2021 exam and 2022 exam. We will as a team do very well. Now we know the length and breadth and the broad framework of how the questions are being asked. So we will not leave any leaf unturned, any stone unturned, and we will be focused and we will crack and do big in the next ensuing 2021 exam. Okay guys, see you all. And bye.